this book I recently read called The Midnight Library by a guy called Matt Haig, where I mean, I won't get into what the book's really about, but it's really just the idea that so much of your life is dependent on the choices that you make, and how, you know, certain choices, small choices, might actually influence your life in very big ways. And really, there's no way for us to actually preempt this, but to go through that process. And you know, I'm sitting here before this group of students and teachers, and trying to kind of talk about what you know, the kind of work that we do and what we are in the process of doing. But really, whatever articulation I have of the practice and of the work is purely in hindsight. It is, you know, like they say, and that's the reason why actually the title of my talk is Hindsight is 2020. It's, you know, when you look back, everything seems to, you know, work along a certain route, but it's not the way that that one's actually kind of thought about practice and where we are at and where we will be going. So I'm just going to start off with this. Again, like I said, this is in hindsight that now when I look back, I kind of clearly see that there were four impressions of practice that came out of, in some sense, interests, in some sense, the logical step that you took from one project to the next, and what were your learnings, and so on and so forth. So what's really come out for me in that sense has been four major practice formats. One is the studio, which is a typical format where you have a client coming to you for a project and he pays you and you do the project. The second is a kind of collaborative model of practice where, you know, working across the breadth of the country, you don't necessarily know everything that is to know about a particular site. You might not. And when that is the condition, when that happens, and when you're in that kind of situation, what really enriches a kind of project is to also bring on stakeholders within the project who would know more about the project than you would. And I think some of our most interesting projects come out of that kind of collaborative framework. The third kind of practice model that we've been working on, which was also mentioned a little bit in the introduction, is this idea of the collective and how, for instance, the collective that we operate called the Bandra Collective is a group of six architectural practices that primarily work pro bono on spaces, public spaces in Mumbai. And we've done a few of these. We've done some work that is reactive to the COVID crisis as well. So what happens is the kind of sum of the collective operates at a scale and at levels that are much much more, let's say, spread out than the individual's capacity. And lastly, this idea of research as a model of practice. And, you know, we typically tend to hear, and this is especially for, you know, students who are in their final year and who have graduated in their master's program, so on and so forth, that, you know, you tend to think about school and practice being two completely different things, right? I mean, this is something that is almost ingrained in us, ki haan, ye toh hum log rahe hain, school mein, college mein seekha tha, but, you know, you're working and this is not something that you can do. But that's not necessarily true, and that research can also be, in some sense, you know, projective of how practice can develop. And I think there is, it's good to kind of hold on to that ideal as you go forward into practice. So this is just like a quick recap. What I'm going to do is run through a couple of projects in brief, and then get into some ideas as we kind of move forward, some larger projects. But I can always kind of come back and look at a project if someone has a specific question regarding that particular project. So these are some of the projects that are already well published and well known. So you'll probably already know some of this. This is, of course, from Jethwan. And the idea that we had in Jethwan, where you could actually be within, you know, a kind of building, but yet visually connect to the foliage of trees outside. That diagram actually kind of developed the entire architecture of the project. For us, what was really important about the project also was the fact that there was a material ecology that we worked with. And, you know, every building in some sense has linkages to its context, immediate context where it's sited, but also to places where you also access resources from. So where you actually get your stone from, where people who work on your project come from, so on and so forth. So there is a material and resource ecology that you work within. So in this case, what we were doing was actually working with waste stone dust from a basalt quarry, which was maybe about 10 minutes away from our site, with waste cement slag that came out as a byproduct from the molasses factory. It was basically fly ash, one cement, sorry, it was fly ash that came out as a byproduct. And then also kind of reappropriated brick from other buildings, repurposed, upcycled timber from old ships in Alang, and then roof tiles that we actually got from other projects that were demolished. So that's, of course, the project. You see that the walls are actually built out of compressed and rammed stone dust. So they are stone, basalt stone dust walls. Because of the fact that they are stone dust, they have a kind of texture to it. So it's very tactile. It kind of invites you to touch it, like that little girl's doing when she's walking by. The structure of the project is actually very simple. It's basically these two stone dust walls on either side. There is a brick pier at either end, and in the middle there is a concrete beam slash gutter that actually is also used to cart away water and store it in a climate that's extremely hot and dry. This is really the diagram that I showed right in the beginning, where when you're within the project, you're still able to kind of see the trees outside. So you end up, in some sense, blurring that line between what is inside, what is outside. The second project that I will kind of quickly just touch upon is the idea of the way that we actually operate today in our kind of globally networked world, where while you might build at a particular site, you are no longer locked in locationally. You're not just limited to what you know of in that geographical location. Because of the networks we sit in, we now have access to start looking at our learning from other disciplines, other people, both in terms of location, but also through time, to be able to learn from all of that and then actually make what is being built locally much richer. So this is actually a project that we, that the library project that we did. It's the Maya Somaya Library. It's built using a 16th century Catalan tile bolting system, kind of construction system that was then innovated with in Uruguay by this fantastic engineer called Eladio Dieste, who worked with compression rings and did some incredible work with tile vaults. We then used software from, cutting edge software at that point, from the ETH Zurich, from the block research group to help us calculate the compression of the structure itself. So there was a fair amount of engineering that we actually did on the project ourselves. And then finally, we used local material and built local brick tile and built in Maharashtra. The point here is the fact that while we might be building in very kind of rural areas or areas or peri-urban areas, we still sit on knowledge networks that would be kind of that would connect us, you know, across the world. So, you know, Lefebvre back in the 70s talked about how while you know, there's no single place in the world that is not a part of an urbanization network, whether through food or movement or climate. I think that this is back in the 70s, right? So we are obviously at a point that's far more connected than that. So there is this potential to be able to leverage these kind of global knowledge networks, not hold them in opposition to what is local, but really in some sense supporting, symbiotic to each other. This is, of course, the project. This is a kind of vault that is about 150 feet long. It's 25 feet at its widest. It's 4.5 inches thick. It's completely in compression. There are no concrete columns or beams. That's the inside of the project. It's basically a very simple kind of pavilion-like structure. But what's really you tend to miss also is the fact that the openings and the way that we'd actually structured them has glass at the bottom, yes, but it actually has mesh at the top, which allows for movement of air. So the entire structure is, again, both these projects are actually about 4 to 5 degrees cooler during the the summers than you would have in a typical building next to it. What you also see is the fact that none of the fans or the other kind of infrastructure, lights, actually happen on the ceiling. Everything happens from the wall, or the low walls, the floor, or the shelf, or the shelving itself. This is to prevent kind of upthrust on the vault. You don't want upthrust in a compression structure. So that's how that detail originated. So what's also interesting is the fact that, you know, while there are constraints in a project, these constraints can also be kind of manipulated or kind of be articulated as ways to reorganize a kind of spatial quality within such spaces. So this aspect of this the next project that I'm showing is actually a project where we were building a very simple kind of manufacturing unit. It's a factory on the outskirts of Bombay in Bhiwandi. But what was interesting about the site was the fact that it was a corner site, yes, but it also had a depression on the site, on the yellow corner that you see at the right bottom. And it was actually a space where water would gather during the monsoons, whenever the adjacent water pond got filled in, there would be both water coming up from the ground, because water finds its own level, and also a spillage from surface runoff. So what we try to do is try to retain that natural phenomena on our site, and to then imagine the entire project as kind of being built around this kund of sorts, which fluctuates between the monsoons. So what you actually see here is a section where the entire building actually cantilevers over that. We didn't want to put any columns, etc., on that kund to kind of prevent any kind of foundation work being done there. So what you actually see is how that monsoons actually have the water kind of lining up and the site flooding. These are just some images of the project. This is the kund. The next part that I want to talk about is also something that ties back into this idea of research. And in 2019, this was just before the lockdown, we were invited to actually participate in the Seoul Biennale and also curate a small India section. So what we did was we actually got together 10 practices that talk about how architects and architecture can actually operate within the collective city. And there were four major categories between which we kind of operated. There was this idea of how architecture within the city works with celebratory kind of formats, where the work of the Start Foundation, Bus Ride, Abin Design Studio, they work with these pavilions that they do within public spaces, where art becomes a part of the city. The second is the idea of how you can design public space. Architecture Red in Chennai, the Bandra Collective here in Bombay, which we are a part of as well, does a lot of that. Then there is, of course, this idea of mining through memory, and how there is a repository that's built of cities in history and in the kind of current format. So some incredible work that Rohan and Mukul are doing with film. Their recent movie has really been about LIC, Charles Courier's LIC complex, and from a very kind of personal point of view. But incredible work with Riaz and Antil Design Studio in Ahmedabad, looking at the stepwells and their historic kind of fabric and how they are actually kind of existing today. And then finally, this idea of resistance and how advocacy can also be an incredibly potent way to actually start looking at an architectural practice. And the work of Adarnira and Arvind Adarkar, Hussein and Shweta, P.K. Das and Associates. So all of these various practices create very interesting ways to actually look at what the architectural format for practices can be. It could be either one of these, it could be a combination of these, or it could be many, many more versions as well. And each of these has a certain kind of, let's say, a certain kind of agency and certain kind of instruments that they actually work with. And our Biennale installation really kind of looked at documenting their work. And we were also invited in the same Biennale to actually showcase our own work that we were doing within the practice individually. And some of the new research that we are kind of engaging with right now is develop and control regulations to actually look at how, while we as architects want to have a say in the city through our built projects. However, the built projects are a function of the DCR, the building code that's being implemented In our cities. And what we actually started doing was going back into the history of the city to start looking and analyzing how the semantics of building code actually create very specific kinds of architectural fabric. And I think it's become even more evident, given the time that we are in today, that there is such a close linkage with health and with light and ventilation that has come to the fore given the kind of pandemic that we're facing. This drawing actually is of a rehousing colony built by the government in Bombay, where the distance between two buildings is not more than 10 feet. You can kind of stretch across and shake someone's hand. What was interesting about this project also is the fact that every household has at least one member who suffers from TB or some other respiratory disease. These are facts that were documented by an NGO called Doctors for You, and this research is available online. So what we were trying to see what is the kind of DCR that allows for this kind of habitation to happen, and how you can actually make a small change in the language of the DCR to create an architecture that's much more sympathetic to habitation. And to also trace elements of architecture that we see in Bombay today, and to see how they came, how they evolved, how in some sense you were able to see the podium come out as a form of building, which obviously has its own challenges, because the podium very often gets used for parking. And as you can imagine, if you have just parking for the next ground plus three or four building, and then the actual habitable floors above, you end up creating extremely dead streets. So all of this is in some sense encoded into the DCR of our cities. And what we were trying to do is really just unpack that and then kind of see how we can create better regulation for that. I'm also trying to give you a sense of how we've gone from a kind of commissioned project to a research project to now a kind of collective project. This is some of our recent work. This is on Carter Road, which is in Bandra. This is an entire kind of skating park and a promenade that we designed and built. This was work that we were doing along the pandemic, where we were saying that, you know, things are going to open up. How do we actually address public spaces when people come back on the streets? So we were kind of looking at various scales of engagement, from flooring patterns to redesign mobile carts, to look at just even hand washing systems and how we could look at recycling that water. And some of this got built as well, and it was in the news. That's just to give you a sense of the four models of practice that I talked about. And while I've actually talked about them individually, I have to also say that they don't necessarily operate in silos. They're constantly informing each other. And I think that really is in some sense particular to the context that we work in, maybe India, maybe the subcontinent, or maybe even East Asia, where we actually work with such varied kind of stakeholders, actors within a project, that there is almost a kind of schizophrenic model of practice that's needed to be able to address everything appropriately. The next project, I'm going to now get into projects with a little bit more detail. This is a project that we recently finished. It was earlier this year, actually, and it was it received the Wallpaper Design Award for the best public building of the year. It's actually based out of this idea of how do you actually look at a religious space? What is the tie-in with water? And it has traditionally been something that's always existed when we actually looked at whether it's a ghat or it's a kund, and how do you actually create an architecture of that response to water? And what we were trying to do was then start looking at this relation between water and the step and the actual building. And really, that's for us the project. It is a very kind of straightforward entry. You actually come in here. The first minor temple shrine is on this side. Then you come into the main shrine here. This is where the community kitchen is. You actually have the priest's quarters there, and there's a courtyard for the priest as well. So that's really the kind of format. And what you see here is a water body that we actually made on the lower part of our site, primarily because what we actually found on our site was the fact that the nearby quarry where JSW was quarrying for limestone to make cement at their plant was producing a lot of water as byproduct. And in this particular area, the because of the kind of nature of soil and the lack of water, there has been a dramatic shift in the cultivation of crops that the farmers have had to go through, going from more kind of water intensive crops to something that is that doesn't need as much water, like chili and so on and so forth. So what we were trying to do is trying to see if we could in some sense start using the temple program is also an ecological project. And we hence that kind of overlap with water actually happens because of that, where we are now being able to take water that comes out of from the quarry, putting it in the kund, which runs through phytoremediation planting along the edge. It recharges the groundwater, and whatever is excess, and there's a lot of excess, is then kind of filtered back into the landscape, into the landscape of the farmers' fields. So it actually works both at a kind of ecological level as well as a kind of socio-cultural scale. And yeah, that's just to give you a sense of how that's that temple situated. You see the JSW plant in the background. Yeah, that's just to again kind of lay out the temple. And like I was saying, you're entering from the left-hand side and then kind of moving in to the Varaha Swami shrine and then finally to the Balaji shrine itself. There's a beautiful video that actually Edmund shot of the temple, which is online. If you can just Google it, you'll find it. Actually, shows you a lot more of the temple. But really, for me, this image is actually very telling. It's really about how the temple, kind of responds to water. How where the ghat stops, where the temple begins, is actually a very fuzzy line. And you can also see in the way that people are kind of engaging with the temple itself, in the way that they actually use the steps as a means to sit. And as not as an object that has to be distanced from, it's also it also creates a very unusual kind of intimate relationship with the building, which I think is fascinating, especially given the times that we actually again kind of live in with the kind of polarization that religion seems to cause. I think it's great when we're able to be able when we're able to kind of leverage a religious format to do more than just talk about a specific religious program. That's the interior. It's actually to also kind of just describe it a little bit. It's actually built out of limestone from the area, so it's actually corbelled limestone blocks, really big blocks that sit one on top of the other, which finally then are keystoned by that. The skylight that you see at the top. So, I mean, it's interesting also that this temple obviously has kind of gotten some critical kind of recognition, but also when it was first built, we got a lot of we got well we got flak from the left that talked about how this temple is another kind of instance of how we are building a kind of Hindu nationalistic kind of strain. And then also from the right, who were saying that this is not really a temple, it's a temple for Scientologists and things like that. So it's really interesting that when you're walking that tightrope, you get in some sense roger by both the left and the right. But I think this is also interesting as a sign of things to come, and the fact that the publicness of a building, even if it's a private building now, is something that you must kind of recognize. And the fact that we got attacked from both sides, I think was also in some sense good. It kind of showed us that we were able to service both aspects of resistance that you actually have in society. So this next project is a small project we did in Goa. It's called, and we call it the House of Multiple Courts, because it was actually built around a series of trees that exist on our site and a well that you actually see right at the entry. So what we did was we basically tried and fit in programs wherever we actually didn't have trees. So you essentially did a very kind of let's say a tessellated kind of plan, which has openings every kind of maybe 10 meters you'll find a kind of open courtyard. Yeah, it's just a kind of depiction of that. But just to also kind of talk about you know, how we actually process, we do an incredibly large amount of physical models. And these aren't necessarily models that are used to show clients, though we do actually show clients all the models. Here I'm just showing you one model, but we probably, to get to this point, we did about maybe 15 or 20 versions of this at various scales. So yeah, I mean, it's in some sense, while we also use a lot of technology in the work that we do with software and with production mechanisms, 3D printed concrete, parametric software, but we're also very hands-on in the way that we actually look at other tools like models to build with. So this is just to give you a sense of the project. It's in Goa, like I said. It's set within the outskirts of a village. So from the outside, it's actually a very silent building. It just sits on site. It's with jali. That's all that you can see. And the corbel, the corbelled corner is really the only way that you actually find out that there's an entry to go in. These are just some details of the project. That's the site that faces the north and faces the river, which is completely kind of opened out. These are just some more images of that. And these are some of the views of the courtyards inside. That's the actual courtyard with the tree and the well in it, and these are little kind of openings that we did to allow people to look back out into the village, to always kind of keep an eye on what the context is, where you're actually kind of situated. And of course, it's built out of a load bearing laterite, so this is a local kind of Goan stone. Again, this is a project that we've just recently finished. I mean, finished it last year. You know, anything 2 years ago, even 2 years ago, is fairly recent. What we were actually doing was creating, you know, kind of campus set of buildings for an existing school, which was supposed to be kind of built over time in phases. And this is outside of Bombay. It's in an area called Badlapur. It sits right next to this very nice stream of water which runs by, and the way that the campus had parts of the campus had been made was the fact, I mean, like, they were kind of designed in a way that the buildings were completely disconnected from that water line. So what we were trying to do was trying to create the new buildings in a way that they would link you back visually through streets to the water promenade as well. We developed the second stage. So that's really a kind of master plan of the project. I won't go get into too much detail. I'm happy to come back to this if there are questions that need to be answered. But these are just some visuals of it as work kind of progresses. This is the kind of building skin of the project. What we are trying to do is actually look at structure also becoming a set of shading systems. So where there is structure, which is a structural system, which is a kind of shading mechanism, is not completely clear, though. I mean, it's also columns that actually move. They don't stay in one above the other continuously. They're also being staggered along the periphery. So the entire edge is a kind of grid, a structural grid that works together, rather than it being a column structure that works from floor to floor. Yeah, just some more visuals of this. So again, these are some projects that are recently finished. So we don't, this is still under construction actually. So it's, I'm just showing you projects that you might not have seen before. So this is a part of the gym block. It's it's basically kind of oriented northwards. So you get north light coming into the spaces. It's just a series of, again, kind of structural edges that hold program behind it. Again, we do a lot of work with educational institutes. This is another project that we're actually working on. It's actually finished, but we're doing some more work in addition to this, where we've built both an existing IT college for them, as well as added a cafeteria to the building. So the cafeteria actually is a kind of dining pavilion, which had to be temporary. So it's built out of steel and translucent roofing material because it has a lot of trees. So what we were trying to do is trying to see if we could actually, you know, capture some of that shadow on the translucent material sitting under the foliage. What you see here is, in some sense, the detail that makes the project. That's the kind of column that sits away from the plinth. It has a bracket that has beams that support the seat. Lighting's kind of built into that column as well. And finally, the column holds the kind of structure for the roof from above. So at the bottom, you see this membrane that runs clear and don't see the structure of columns and beams. You don't see the structure of beams at the bottom. These are just some images of that detail. You can see some of that. You can also kind of see the connection of the dining pavilion with the other block that we've designed. And it really sits almost like this kind of pavilion within that landscape of trees and kind of weaving in and out in the space that is available to the pavilion. So, I'm also showing you some projects that talk about the approach to site and to how we typically try and address concerns that have to do with ecological existing ecological phenomena. So this is a project that we are doing in Goa. It's a kind of master plan for a set of 14 bungalows. It's a site that's kind of low lying. So what we actually did was, in the monsoon that was happening, was the center of the site was filling up. So we actually regraded our site in a way that we took out some material from here and actually piled it up in the middle where we put the houses and let the edges then be the parts that get submerged during whenever there is flooding. That also then led us to the way that we imagined the center, which becomes almost like a street, and the form of the house then is kind of articulated to allow you to actually experience the sky when you walk through that street. So you see these are two variations that we had tried, but the one on the right is the one that we built. The street always has the public program, which is the one that has the living and the dining opening out into the street. So you're always creating an interface between what is public and what is private. These are just kind of drawings that explain the form of the house and what is the kind of logic of creating that particular form. These are images of the physical massing model that we had done. Just to give you a sense of scale, these are images from site. Like I said, this is also a project that's currently being built as we speak. This is a project that we've done in Hyderabad. It's again a kind of housing project where we've built a single building. We actually designed the building working in a way to create chhajjas for the windows, but using the walls as structure to hold the chhajjas up. So the chhajjas are actually made of solid stone, and the load of those chhajjas is then taken by the corbelled walls that you actually see on the sides. This is a diagram that actually represents the various formats of corbelling that we were working on. But what's also interesting in some sense for us is the fact that when we were working with actually masons who were doing the brickwork were quite fantastic, but to get them to actually work on the corbelling, we also, while of course we were kind of happy with the final object that we got, but I think what we were actually happier about was also the fact that we ended up designing these tools, very low-tech tools for the masons to get the corbelling right. So what you actually see here is the bottom brick alignment. This is the next brick alignment to kind of get the corbel right, so that the structure, so that the corbels perform structurally. So sometimes it's not just about designing the project, it's also about designing the tools that would make the project. This is a project that we are doing in Kota, which is also almost complete now. So this is actually, I don't know if you've been to Kota, and some of you might have. This is a newer part of Kota where buildings are built edge to edge. They're almost like row houses, but they are ground plus four, ground plus five. With very little light and ventilation, they're completely packed and planned. But what we were trying to do was trying to, in some sense, by creating an opening at the bottom here, you're able to actually connect with the garden behind. So the street that connects all of these houses together is extremely dead. It has absolutely no green on it. But by the simple gesture of opening up the bottom of our program, we are able to create a visual connect across to the other side where there is a garden. So the architectural project also, in some sense, turns urban in the way that you articulate the form of the project. The center is a kind of courtyard around which you actually have hostel room structured, and the final floors of the building actually have the owners living in it. So it's actually, this diagram kind of captures it a little bit better. That's the center courtyard. Those are the kind of offsets that we made for terracing, as well as that opening at the bottom to allow for views into the green area. That's a plan at ground. So you can see this is where you kind of enter in. That's that courtyard. There's another further sunk courtyard with a tree in it. And then that's the visual that connects you to the green area behind. These are upper floor plans where the hostel rooms are at. And then finally at the floor where the owners live, there's a kind of bridge that connects both sides, so it becomes more accessible. And that's just to give you a sense of the section of the project and the proportion of the courtyard in the middle, and how we actually detailed the skin of the project, which is really almost a series of jarokhas that we actually developed in solid kota stone. And that's really the kind of building form. Again, like I said, it's under construction, so it should also finish soon, hopefully. But it's just a sneak preview. This is a project that we are working on in Shimla, actually. Well, not Shimla, it's in a place called Mahasu, which is about 2.5 hours further up from Shimla towards Kinnaur. It's the Apple Belt. And there is an old fort called the Mahasu Fort, which was derelict, which was bought by one of our clients. And what we've been trying to do is trying to develop kind of restoration of the project through adaptive reuse, to try and use whatever material of the project was there, and to create in some sense the kind of architecture of the fort type, but at the same time still look at programs of hospitality, which is what the brief actually entails. So that's just to give you a sense of scale across that entire valley and how it actually occupies this this beautiful kind of plateau on top of the hill. So these are just some kind of indications of the plan, a simple kind of courtyard plan, and this is just a kind of GIF of the study model and how it actually works with traditional formats of the cantilever and the Katkhuni construction system. This is another project that we are actually working on for JSW in Vijayanagar, where we're doing a bus terminus. And I'm just going to explain that through a video and these models, but the video should play, yeah. So it's actually at a junction. It's a interstate bus terminus. So it's going to be something that requires large public spaces. What we were trying to do was work with a structural system that allowed people that you can do large spans through, but at the same time, you're also able to create these nice kind of waiting areas between intervals to the other program. So the entire project, in some sense, is glorified structure and little else. So these are just images of the model. Of course, this model is in cast concrete, and those little red blocks give you a sense of the scale of the model. This is a project that's actually very it's very interesting for me personally, and also for me, it's actually a project that I was very kind of petrified to do. It's on a hill, on a hillside behind here. What you see here in front are Charles Correa's villas in Verim. So we were building behind, in some sense, the master's project, and I was always kind of very petrified about the fact that I was building relatively next to a Correa building, and I didn't want to do disservice to both the architecture of Correa's fantastic but very beautiful, very humble villas. I don't know if some of you've seen it, but you should. It's really a very nice plan. But also, how do you actually kind of use that type of the bungalow? And when people want to buy something in kind of Goa, they don't want to live in an apartment, right? Even though that was the program that we were actually asked to work with, they want to live in villas, right? They want to kind of get access to ground. So what we were trying to do was then trying to create an architecture that works with this idea of the bungalow, but the bungalow spread around, on much smaller formats, sharing courtyards built on a slope, and the kind of C and L-shaped plan are able to kind of structure one and two bedroom units along the lower floors, and the three bedroom unit that actually sits right on top. So this is a little miniature, and representation is something that's very important to the practice, and we really enjoy, in some sense, drawing our imaginations of the project, not just from you know, a kind of technical point of view, but also just from a kind of fun and playful point of view. So you'll see someone's kind of parachuting down into the main courtyard. There are two kids playing cricket. There is a cat on a hot tin roof, you know, kind of reference as well. So these are just plans to kind of give you a sense of how the format works. And of course, this is something that is critical, that how do you actually work services while you do this, because the building stepping back as well. How do you develop structure? How do you develop, you know, ducts that would run, pipes that would run along? So, yeah, so I mean, you know, when you can kind of look at the final project, you don't see all of that complexity, but really to make something look simple, you you know, you also have to kind of put in a lot of complex hard work and modeling into the project. You know, there's a story, I don't know if you've heard, it's very difficult to kind of, you know, it's like veer off and tell stories because one's not really sure as to how the audience is, especially in a kind of online session. But, you know, there's a story about Mahatma Gandhi and how there was a journalist, an American journalist who came to see him in the Sabarmati Ashram and said that, oh, we've heard so much about the simplicity of Mr. Gandhi's existence. You know, he just has this one gadda and the charkha, and we want to see that. So they took him to that room and they saw where Mahatma Gandhi sat and all of that, and the simplicity and the minimalist kind of feel in the room. And then that guy who was showing the reporter around said that, you know what, let me also show you what we have to do to enable this kind of simplicity. And they took him to the next room where there were these host of telegraph wires, lots of papers lying around and a complete mess. He said, to keep that simple, you know, this is what we actually have to do to enable that simplicity. So it's in some sense that, you know, the kind of simpler the project, the more complex the kind of articulation of what makes that simplicity happen. This is a project that we won back in 2016, the National War Museum at India Gate in Delhi. Well, not exactly India Gate, at Princess Park. I'm just kind of running through this. I had not shown this project too much. There is a kind of ongoing court case which we filed, but I mean, that's a different story. But just to give you a sense of the project itself, what you actually see is the site of Princess Park. That is Amar Jyot, or that's India Gate, sorry, that's the Amar Jyot. That's a series of public buildings that actually sit along that main access that takes you to Rashtrapati Bhavan, which is now the Central Vista project, of course. And what we were actually doing was, we were starting off with the premise that when you actually go along this axis, there are a couple of public buildings. You have the auditorium, you have the NSD, you have the National History Museum. But if you actually look at the edge of that, of each of these buildings, there are always high walls that separate the street from the actual public building. And what we were arguing for is the fact that in a museum, since it's completely they're black box spaces, typically we could actually look at shifting the galleries completely up, you know, upstairs, and to look at the ground floor as a public plaza, as a public program, which would allow anybody to come in. And the kind of programs that you would put in would be cafes, it could be a kind of small OAT, some temporary exhibition facilities, gift shops, so on and so forth. But really a kind of public space that could be accessible for everyone, even people who don't want to go to the galleries. What we were also doing was working with the existing trees. There were a huge number of trees on site, and try and conserve those. So we actually mapped the footprint of the trees and their spreads to see how much area we actually have to use. And then actually looked at that as the building footprint for the project. And what we were then starting to do was trying to look at how do you actually program the galleries. Now, typically what tends to happen in most projects, in most museum projects, is that you get a very strong brief from the client. And a few of these projects that we are working on now, that's been the case as well. But in this one, there wasn't a brief. So we were actually also developing, in some sense, the structure of the gallery and the exhibits, even though they had not explicitly said that. So what we said was, if we imagine the building being a kind of timeline of India, and we looked at stacking the Navy and the Army and the Air Force galleries one on top of the other, not separating them as separate buildings, but really just stacking them one on top of the other, we then map the role of each of these armed forces at various points in India's history, to then get a sense of what mass, where you actually have, let's say, the Air Force involved, you'll actually see the mass. Where you don't, you won't see it. Now, what that did for us was actually create a movement, not through space, not through a gallery space, but through time. So you were actually going from each of these galleries to the next, going through timelines. And that structure really became the architecture of the project. So the timeline, in some sense, became the project. And what you ended up doing is then contrasting that with the public plaza in the building, at the bottom of the building, with the solid monumentality that you would actually get in the other buildings that already existed nearby. So we were trying to kind of also reference the language from the fact that there is the Jantar Mantar very close by, and the fact that these two ideas then, in some sense, generate the architecture for our project, and that's the way that it kind of occupies the edge of our site. So again, like I said, the porosity, the kind of openness is what we were actually going for in the project. And that's the way that it sat completely, again, kind of, dissipating wherever you actually had trees. And these actually become on the inside, these light wells that also bring natural light into our gallery spaces. So when, as opposed to a regular museum where you would actually go into a gallery, then go to the next gallery, what we actually have is a series of 1:25 ramps that allow you to move between galleries. So when you're moving through time, you're not only going across the floor, you're also going up and down wherever the gallery space might be interrupted because of trees. You take a ramp and go around a tree from an upper floor and see the gallery there, then come back. So it works both with time as well as the landscape that we actually have on site. Various circulation paths for each of the kinds of users that we had, we expected on site. I won't get too many details, but what you actually see here is the fact that our building only touches the ground at 11 places. This is where you have cores of movement, vertical movement, where you have entrances, you have exits, you have VIP access, auditoriums, cafes. So these 13 points become structural to allow for people, for the entire project to, in some sense, span over these massive kind of trees, and between the massive trees, as well as creating these massive public spaces where you can also do temporary exhibits for people to come to. These are partial basements that we actually worked with, where you could actually move between the basements, also see how the artifacts were stored, so that the storage also becomes a part of the experience. These are plans at the level of the Navy Gallery, where you can see that there is a kind of interruption in the gallery space. So if I have to go from, let's say, this end of my gallery to this end, I have to take a ramp up, climb across, and then come towards the side. And these are formats of those ramps. You can see how seamless they would be in terms of an experience. And it's only the Army Gallery that is able to kind of go across completely. And this is a position where you actually see both the Air Force, the Army Gallery, which is the middle section, and then finally the Navy Gallery at the bottom. And you can also see how the gallery spaces are punctuated by the trees that you that the building is kind of situated. It also creates this kind of big kind of amphitheater at the rooftop, which allows you views into that central kind of vista of South Block that you typically wouldn't be able to get from anywhere, and a vantage to the Republic Day Parade and so on and so forth. So that's the section. Because of the varying heights that we are working with, you also get these massive spaces to actually have big planes that are also suspended in that space. So the exhibit scales also are kind of varied. There are water bodies that also generate a kind of microclimate that would make the building cooler. And that's just to give you a sense of the section of the building and the way that the section's constantly interrupted by trees that are existing on the current footprint. I already talked about this. There's a kind of there's also energy kind of consciousness in the way that the project was imagined. Bureau Happold were our consultants on the project. They were our structural consultants as well. So the entire outer structure is a shotcrete, concrete pigmented structure. There are big wall panels that open and close the back to allow for artifacts to be brought in. And then there are some more visuals of these courtyards. There are also breakaway spaces in between, because the entire length of one long walk through the galleries is about 1.8 kilometers. So there would be a need for breakout spaces. And this is the topmost floor from which you actually link to the rooftop amphitheater. This is just some images of the model. And that's the. So what we also were doing was while we were in our kind of naivety, waiting to hear back after winning the competition. We were also trying to develop various versions of this that would also have the same kind of spatial structure, but would work with a language that would be simpler to fit in with what the DOAC mandated as the kind of material and texture for buildings in that zone. However, that didn't really help. So there are various versions that we developed for that. So the second project that I'm going to show, or the last project actually, I think, is the Maharashtra Nature Park. It's a competition that we won in 2016 as well. So 2016, we won these two big competitions where we were actually looking at this small little estuary right there. Right here. So it's this is of course the sea. There is a river that comes in from the national park that comes down here and then kind of flows into the sea. But of course, since this is there is also a kind of since it's an estuary, you also get water coming back during high tide into this. So this is a salt water kind of mix here with the fresh water that comes in from the higher reaches. And back in the 70s, this area along that river stretch was a dump yard. It was where Bombay dumped its garbage for a long time. It was capped back in the 1970s. And what was interesting about the site is also the fact that it sits bang in the middle of what is probably a very kind of peculiar Mumbai situation in terms of social divide that you see. On this side is actually Dharavi. And that side, you actually have some of the most expensive commercial real estate in Bombay. That's BKC. And this is the Maharashtra Nature Park. So this dump yard was capped in the 70s and trees were grown on it. What is interesting, however, is that the river that runs to it is extremely polluted. It's the Mithi River. And this river actually was brought back into Mumbai's imagination after the floods in 2006, this river completely flooded everything. Dharavi, BKC, everything got flooded. About 1,000 people lost their lives. So this river has, in some sense, been a recent addition in the imagination of Mumbai citizens. However, the way that we are treating the river is pathetic. And the brief of the competition, however, dealt specifically with the park that we were looking at, the nature park. We were looking at creating a pedestrian bridge linking BKC to the park. And we needed to create an architectural component on site, which was for a kind of resource center, a welcome center for people who are coming to the park, and so on and so forth. But we were very clear in our kind of approach initially that we cannot build a successful park if we do not talk about its context and how the river is an integral part of the park, of the park's ability to actually reimagine itself. And this is just to give you a sense of the larger ecosystem. And bear in mind, I'm just kind of reiterating this, that our competition really was just about this and a bridge that we had to build here. However, we actually expanded our focus to look at land use around this entire area, the slums that there were, the open spaces that you had, the mangroves that existed on our site. And this was what I was talking about. That about this is when 1,000 people died in the rains that caused the Mithi to flood. It's incredibly kind of sad, but that in some sense got people to take notice of the fact that there was a river that we had forgotten about. It's some images. So, and the reason why this happened was because of the fact that the actual floodplains of the Mithi are all these blue areas that you see right along that. So that is the Mithi floodplain, and that Mithi floodplain, because of the kind of building and the reclamation that's happened, is now relegated to being only that strip that you see in between. So when there is a 100-year flood, this is going to happen. We, to understand this, traced our steps back into history, to look back before the kind of unification of these various islands that Bombay finally became. The east and the west coast of Bombay was actually linked by a waterway. In fact, even today, when you actually look at forts that were essentially sea forts, they're built along the inner edge. So today there is no kind of water line that connects it, but the forts still exist within this part that guard the sea land in some sense. So what we were kind of also arguing for is the fact that maybe one way to also look at our context is to see if we can open up that waterway again. That's really a kind of current scenario. After the floods, what the BMC did was they actually said that, this is This is what the slum is like. That's the water carrying capacity as it is currently. What we will do is we will talk about redevelopment through the SRA model. So you will be building, high rises for the slums to rehouse slum dwellers, and we will build a kind of concrete wall against the water, which of course is ridiculous because that's not how water operates, especially with kind of flooding and global warming. Water levels will rise. So what we were suggesting was actually a kind of strategy that was much more temporal, where we were saying that what we should do is actually build all of the SRA schemes for the back and to look at a community space that's actually created along the edge of the water, a space that during flooding is not usable, but this is nothing unusual. The Kumbh Mela actually happens, the largest gathering of people in the world happens on exactly the same situation where, we are actually kind of hosting the entire festival on a riverbed, which become when the water flow is low. So what we were trying to say is that this is something that can become a part of the imagination of how public spaces can appear during low tide and can disappear when the tide's kind of gone. And of course, there were certain programs that we allocated. There was already cultivation happening by some of the people who lived in the slums. But we were also adding this kind of layer of phytoremediation to that and to look at how we could clean water that was coming out of the SRA. And then that fresh water is then directed into the Mithi River. So these are just kind of existing pictures. But what we also found was when we actually investigated the site, we found that this is on the left. The leftmost image is actually how the garbage dump had been capped back in the 70s. This on the right is actually the capping system that you have today in operation. So what you actually ended up doing was basically trapping all of the methane gas that's kind of created because of the decomposition of all the waste under soil. So what we also found on our site was there were these kind of red pockets where trees were not surviving for very long, were falling very easily. And we assumed, because there was no soil report available to us, that subsoil there was a problem here because there was some amount of contamination which didn't allow roots to actually survive. And that became for us a way to start looking at the site and to strategize a series of transects through our site, which would address specifically these concerns, both of the edge of the water as well as the contamination within our site. We also kind of looked at creating small demonstration projects working with engineers from IIT, where these three little tubes actually tell you what is the level of a particular chemical subsoil. So it also gives you a sense, becomes a demonstration project for people to see what is the level of contamination within and how it's improved over time. So that's really the kind of master plan of the project. I won't get into too much detail. There was an existing building that you might have seen earlier, which was in bad shape, which actually had a mural by Kishan Khanna right in the middle. So we actually retained that and built a kind of wooden tower on top of that. So visually it becomes a kind of marker, and expanded the butterfly garden. We created the architecture on this side. But what we also did, and this is actually a part of our kind of brief in some sense, was we actually took some of the space from the park and used that as a part of a public facility which has nothing to do with the park, but which can be used by the people who live in the slums nearby. So it's a public park meant for the slum dwellers, which also has bathrooms that are built as a part of the infrastructure, because currently people living here were defecating in the open along the water edge. So we actually created this entire infrastructure to be able to service that group of people as well. And this is currently the edge of the park. So if you drive by it, you don't even see it. It's a 25-acre park bang in the city of Mumbai, which very few people are aware of. And what we were trying to do was then also start creating this kind of image for the park that finds its way out towards the edge, towards the boundary, using construction rubble, using little kind of bus stands that we were making for people to sit on, for the bus stops that operated on this road, little look-in points from where you can, even without going into the park, climb up and look down into the park itself. And bicycle racks for people who are going to bicycle across from BKC to come to this area. That's really the kind of architectural scheme where this is the underside of the ramp that connects you from the Dharavi side to the BKC side over the water. So under that, we actually put all the admin programs. This on the left is a welcome center. And what you have here is a gallery and library space. And all of these were imagined to be pavilions. So you could look through them literally into the forest that actually sits just behind it. So the buildings were, rather than doing one large building, what we were doing was doing smaller footprints so that we wouldn't occupy too much space and we could position these various buildings within the trees that existed on site and not disturb any of those. So what you see here is the kind of entry shot. This is the welcome center. We also had a series of phytoremediation ponds, as you might kind of remember, where we were actually taking water from the Mithi and cleaning that up in those and then channeling that to show how clean it could be in this water body as soon as you enter. There's a central courtyard where there's a kind of briefing area, amphitheater as well for large groups that come in. And that here is the ramp that's actually taking you towards the bridge and then towards BKC. As a further kind of engagement with the site, what we did was we sliced into our site. We actually created this entire kind of demonstration of when you actually walk down into the space, what the site sits under. So you could actually see the garbage that sits under our site itself to give you a sense of the evolution of the site from what it was to what it's become. And that's really a kind of overview of our site and its connection with the bridge to BKC. I haven't gone into too much detail in any of these projects, but I've just tried to kind of give you a format of what these projects are. I'm happy to kind of discuss any of these as we go further. But I think what I'm also going to end with is this fantastic quote by A.K. Ramanujan, not the mathematician, but the philosopher who had this fantastic essay called "Is There an Indian Way of Thinking?" I don't know if you've read it already. If you haven't, I would strongly recommend it, where he talks about the fact that this question in itself can be reframed every time you place an emphasis on a certain word. So When you ask, is there an Indian way of thinking, you're asking also if there ever was a singular way of Indian way of thinking. When you talk about, is there an Indian way, you talk about what do you define by Indian? Is the idea of India monolithic or is it kind of varied? And when you talk about an Indian way, you talk also about the multiple ways of operation rather than a singular one. So it's a fantastic essay and I would strongly kind of recommend reading it. And I'm just going to end in some sense with some gratifying kind of images that are post-occupancy images. In some sense, this is Jethwan with the courtyard having been completely kind of built out. This is an image that someone who had gone to Jethwan kind of posted on Instagram. It was fantastic to be able to see that the outdoor spaces are now completely operating like outdoor rooms, and the space has a kind of calming quality as yet to it. This is another project that we did in Manali. This is actually one of the first projects that I ever worked on. And to see how, given half a chance, nature has taken over some of this architecture that we designed, that eventually, nature is the far greater architect between us and them. So that's how I'd like to kind of end here. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. It was a wonderful, insightful presentation. Now we can move ahead with the question and answer session. I would request all of the BOs to put their query post. There is one question already lying in our chat box. Sir, this question is that there are some projects of yours in which you question the primary norms.
Yeah.
Some norms, those are created by us, not by the written norm. So how did you manage to bring that in practical world and get your client agreement to it, sir?
So, typically, I think what tends to happen is we tend to look at type. Formal types, programmatic types, in the sense of like they're unchanging, right? But the fact is that there has been so much change in the way that societal structures operate, how cultural models have evolved, that there is no need for there is a need actually for kind of architecture to also allow for that change to happen. And I think that is really a kind of premise that we always operate with, is that if this is the way that it was done, does it need to change today? And if so, what are the parameters that need that change to happen? And as far as clients go, I think what happens is when you actually list out the project logically and you tell, you're able to show how, for instance, what you are proposing as opposed to what they were expecting will add greater perceptible value, not just aesthetic value, but a perceptible change, like temperatures drop by 5 degrees, or the fact that it's a cheaper way to build, and or the construction system is systemic, and you know, you can kind of learn from this and build cheaper, you know, whenever you build again. I think all of that then resonates a lot more with the client once they're able to see that there is a perceptible value change and not just an aesthetic one.
Thank you, sir. So we have another question, sir. It is asked by Kunal Ghatole. It is regarding the famous award-winning project of yours, the Siddheshwar Temple, the Temple of Steps. Did you feel you were compromising ornamental exterior beauty for a functional benefit in that project?
I was compromising on. Yeah, okay. So that's interesting. You know, Khan actually talked about how the joint, Louis Khan talks about how the joint is actually the origin of ornament. Right, so where two materials had to come together, and you had to detail that thing coming together, or when bamboo was being used as a column, or wood was being used as a column, and when it took a stone kind of lintel, it would deflect, which is why you start getting capitals and stuff like that. So that detail really is in some sense the origin of ornament, and you know, I kind of strongly believe in that. I don't believe in the fact that ornament for the sake of ornament is important unless there is a programmatic value. Because today, I think in the times that we live in, we have to be very cognizant of the resources that we are using, given the fact that, you know, resources are limited. So unless the resource creates, again, I'm going to use the word value, that is real, it only makes sense to kind of do it then. If not, then I don't prescribe, you know, to that point of view then, yeah.
Okay. Sir, another question. So this question is about the National War Museum. That right. How the National War Museum would complement or participate in the maintaining the character ongoing Central Vista project. This is something else.
So I don't know. Actually, the extent of the Central Vista project is, I think it encompasses everything. So I don't know. I mean, I believe that there is a lot of public space that has been lost or is going to be lost in the new Central Vista project. But, you know, we were actually kind of operating with the opposite mechanism where we were saying that we create a public space at the bottom. So yeah, I think it would have been nice. It would have been, yes, a part of that.
So another question we have for Jitovan.
Yeah.
The Jitovan project. How does considering the ecology of locally available and obtained resources
right
resonate the user desire of modern industrially produced material that offers sense of permanence?
Right. So it's interesting that the question talks about a sense of permanence, and it's not. So if one is to kind of analyze the idea of permanence, we are actually building with literally stone, right? I mean, that's what we built with in Jethwan. So it doesn't get more permanent than that, but. What you're absolutely right about is in that question is the fact that the users or any user has a set of aspirations. Those aspirations are coded both by what is perceived to be kind of better alternative, what is perceived to be a better alternative, not necessarily is a better alternative. So we actually had a very interesting discussion about this, where we were actually talking to the people who lived around that area, saying that we wanted to do these floors that were made out of mud and dung, which is done typically in villages, so that you're able to tie in some kind of economic benefit to the people who live there. They'll come back and they'll have to do it once a year or twice a year, but they also get some kind of income because of that, as opposed to something that would have been static, where we might have put a tile or a stone and we would have that would have been the end of it. However, I mean, of course, there was a kind of cost consideration as well. You're working with very, very limited costs. But there was also this aspect that sometimes the systemic is not about using a particular material, but it's also about the process that you put in place where the project also kind of grows after a certain time. So if you go into the Jethwan kind of Facebook page, you'll find kind of descriptions of how people, are talking, people who stay there and who use the space, are talking about how the space is 4 to 5 degrees or even more cooler during hot summers where temperatures are up to 45 degrees and stuff like that, and how the flooring is also cool because of the fact that it's mud and so on and so forth. So I think there is a certain amount of kind of conversation that you need to have with the user, which we actually did in that project. Sometimes it works, sometimes of course it doesn't. But there's another interesting story actually from the Shiv temple, which I did not show today. This is one of the early temples, that early projects that we had done, where after the Shiv temple was built, it kind of got a few awards. It was on the cover of Architectural Review. The temple priest from there, and again, this is rural Maharashtra. So he saw the fact, I showed him the picture of the book, and I said, it's come on the cover of the magazine. And he said, oh, it's a very good, very good. But I want a copy, he said. So I was wondering, what are you going to do with a copy? Because it was in English, he doesn't read English. I really didn't know what he was going to do with it. So what he did actually, which was fantastic, was that he took that magazine and went to the collector and told the collector, look how famous our temple is. Now, at least to the nearest village, you make us a road so people can come and see it. So, which was way beyond, any kind of architectural intelligence that we had in the project. So I think there are transformative possibilities for each of these ideas that lie beyond the realm of architecture. And sometimes, even if you look at it through a kind of material lens, that might not be the end of the story of the project. That kind of extends through the way that people actually use it. So,
thank you, sir. So there is another question that is asked by our student Yashi Garg. She wants to ask you about your views about this current pandemic situation. How existing building will be affected during this kind of pandemic?
So, yeah, the thing is, I feel one thing that's really important is to not normalize. Now, the default, and we obviously saw this after the first wave, is that our default format is to go back to So, you normalize anything. Maybe it's kind of human resilience in some sense, but also, foolishness that we tend to not learn as much as we should from our kind of mistakes and our experiences. And I think, I don't know about architecture and building, even though I'm a trained architect, but I definitely feel that healthcare programs, I think that is critical. It's not just about reactive healthcare programs, but it's also preemptive healthcare programs, and how we can actually look at upgrading primary health facilities in our country. So I think that is something that is critical. And obviously that means that there should be architectural kind of components that back that. But its impact on building, like I said, we have a tendency to normalize, which I don't think is going to change much. And we're already seeing this in, various other countries that people are going back to living the way that they were. But I think more than architecture, I think it's healthcare that needs to be looked at.
Thank you, sir. Yeah. Sir, we have a couple of more questions. If you are comfortable, can we go on?
Go ahead.
So, there is a question put up by Harsh Kher. He's asking, how do you tackle the intangible aspect of a building?
I think there's another question before that. Amit is asking about the National War Museum.
Yes.
So it's basically it's like you build vaults and you build domes, but it's gunited concrete. So you basically have a kind of a steel structure in place, and then you're spraying concrete on the entire kind of steel structure. So yeah, that's how we were actually building it. Intangible aspect of a building. Yeah, the thing is, I'm actually, I can show you. Maybe I'll send the pictures. But when you actually walk around the studio, you will see that, like I was saying earlier, that our kind of development process is so intensive that we don't get to the intangible part only. We are kind of trying to figure out the tangible part, which in itself takes so long. So anything intangible really is something that happens, and when it happens in a project is a very happy occurrence. But I have to say that we are more kind of worried about the tangible aspects and how we can better those.
So before we end, sir, I would like to put one of my own question. So there is a book written by you in the name of Housing.
Yeah.
There is a study of 11 projects in Mumbai.
Yeah.
Right, sir. So considering that, these courtyard houses, they do existing all around the globe, right? So is there any parallel or any alternative to this Mumbai chawl houses? So if yes sir, then why don't we see that in abundance in Mumbai?
So I actually kind of explained that a little bit earlier, but to give you to also answer that question, I'm not saying that chawls are the kind of default that are the only way to kind of build housing in Bombay, but there were certain aspects of those chawls that were extremely interesting, and some things that we could have actually learned from in the way that they deal with social space, in the way that they dealt with building elements, in the way that they dealt with windows that would create privacy whenever you needed, which would still allow airflow. In the way that they dealt with structure and also variability in units. I mean, I can keep going on and on. So what I'm trying to say is that I'm not saying that the chawl is a format to work with, but what I'm trying to say is that there is a lot within each of those structures that we can learn from when we actually look at building and going into the future. And there are the reasons why it's not happening in Mumbai, because of what I mentioned right in the beginning, the fact that we are, as architects, responding to a set of frameworks, development control regulations, that tell us that you can build this and you can't build this. Within today's framework, you cannot build a chawl. I mean, to answer that question straight away, you cannot design a chawl because they won't allow you to build it in that particular way. If you see, most of these chawls were actually sitting, site edge to site edge. Some of these had corridors that were longer than 40 meters or something like that. So what I'm trying to get at is the fact that they will not allow you, for instance, to be able to ventilate a room into an internal courtyard unless it's beyond a certain size, which was not necessarily a limitation when people were building. And we're building with common sense and well, considering light, ventilation, all of that. So to kind of answer that question, it's basically this the DCR that needs to be kind of addressed if we have to look at changing the built form of our cities.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. So we have two or three more questions. Can we go ahead with that?
Yeah, okay, sure.
Okay. So how, according to you, should the public space work in and after this pandemic? I think you have addressed this issue before.
Yeah. So yeah. We
will move to next question. How do you see the current scenario of urban poor rehabilitation projects in India? In most cases, they are being shifted to high-rise building, and in the contrast, they are the building of the people of the land having a very close association with the land.
Yeah. So actually, this is a question that our first book actually picks up, and our second book actually tries to kind of answer. What we are saying is that with the state absolving itself of responsibility of providing housing for its urban poor, the only mechanism to actually look at housing is to reimagine financial instruments as well as land formats, to look at maybe something like a land trust to be able to provide this land. Because in Bombay or in other, I'm sure other cities as well, the highest cost really comes from land. Construction costs are very low. So if we are able to start looking at this idea of maybe the government not building, yes, but the government being a facilitator to provide land for people to build on, I think that itself will create a huge, possibility to reimagine kind of housing for the poor in our cities.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I would request.
Sumeep, I have one question.
Okay. Sure.
Sumeep, your architecture is very playful. And I can see that you really, really thoroughly enjoy what you design. So I have two parts to my question. You've traveled the world. And what was your one guiding design principle that became your anchor all these years? And the second, I'm sure you have so many, you would have so many of them, but I just want one. And the second part is that sustainability is very important. I see that you use, take care of the sustainability of the project. So how important is sustainability for you? And if for your requisites are post ranked, where will sustainability stand?
I think, to kind of talk about sustainability being an option, I think is redundant. I mean, the times that we live in, it has to be a part of the project. Without that, I think we do both a disservice to our profession and also a disservice to our being human beings inhabiting a planet quite badly, actually. But yeah, so I think that question of sustainability is definitely something that should not be an option. It should be a given that any project should address that. which is why I don't really like to dwell on the sustainability aspects of the projects that we do, primarily because of the fact that without that, there is no project. Otherwise, it's culture. Otherwise, I mean, you can pretty much do whatever you want. So that is one. The one thing I think that that stuck with me wherever I went in whatever we do actually is basically doubt and curiosity. These are two things I think for me that are critical. Doubt as in everything that we do, whether it's a kind of a design drawing, whether it's a module, it's basically engaging with this idea that we don't know enough, and our entire process is to find out what a solution might be, what a project could be. So for me, I think that is a benchmark for whatever we do. That when we are working on a project, it's really following one step to the next, one clue to the next, so on and so forth. I mean, I never have an idea of what a project is going to be when I start a project. It's always something, and the fun in the project is really finding that out, as to what it what the project becomes. So I think that for me is critical to kind of being curious and always being always being critical in the way that you do anything. So, I mean, being critical, especially about yourself and not about others. I'm sorry.
Thank you. This was actually directed towards the students, what they learned from it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. We have one last question for the paper. It is asked by our final year student. He's asking, what is your advice for the newly graduated student who are graduating in the few weeks? Who will be out of the college bubble and will be thinking about what they need to have actually, in the near future, their practical and theoretical knowledge. How do they actually,
I think there are three things that I would recommend, and these are really kind of generic points, but I think they're very important. Quick to lose your idealism. I know that you hear about how you get out and it's a different world and from what you come for, and immediately you're expected that now you have to lose all that idealism that you had in college and you have to now function as per what real society is. But it's not like that. Stick to your idealism as long as you can. That's my first thing. But while you're doing that, the second point that I'd like to make also is don't be naive about it. The world operates through certain structures. Be cognizant of those structures and approach that through a sense of curiosity and not through a sense of naivety. So that is the second suggestion I would have. And the third thing that I would recommend is what I already said to a certain extent, but the fact that be extremely critical, especially of your own thoughts. Be extremely critical about what you're doing and how you're doing it and what you're going to be doing at the end of it. I think if you can kind of stick with these three premises, you do fairly okay.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay. Now I would like to invite our Dean of Student Welfare, Professor Disha Singh, for the vote of thanks and to close the session for today, please. Disha ma'am.
Hello, everyone. I think a vote of thanks is relatively redundant. I think a lot of us are, according to me personally, given that everything is online, so we are sort of saturated with what we receive.
That's right.
But I believe that what you've shown us today and the way you have put it across, it's been so dynamic and it's just been like idea after idea and just something that has been so refreshing. I believe personally that for the last 1.5 hours, just looking at the projects and hearing you, I don't think there's been a single lull or a dull moment. And if nothing else, the amount of questions that we've been receiving, I think, is reflection enough as to how the audience has perceived your entire lecture. So I really thank you for the time and all the effort. And I just like to compliment you on one thing. We as architects sometimes get very self-absorbed where our projects are concerned. And when we are talking about them, we don't know where to stop or how to. But somehow the way you have conveyed the keynotes and the cores of your projects, it was just apt to the point. and then it moved on to the next thing. So it was, I think this is what the students really needed. They needed this, I want to term it as a bombardment of ideas. It's not just one aspect. And that is something which is needed, because I think all of them are facing this issue of feeling stagnated, feeling like locked in a box. So sometimes you need this kind of stimuli. So thank you so much, Architect Sameer Padora.
My pleasure.
Of course, this entire lecture would not have been possible without our expert lecture team. So we have our assistant professors, Architect Sonia Sharma, Architect Monica, Architect Garishma, Architect Vipendra, and of course, Architect Ghanshyam. And we also have our students who have really been helping us, particularly Tipu and Hemani. Also, the audience who's been here, thank you for the numbers you have turned out in. I just want to inform everyone that not only was the Google Meet full, but at one point I checked the live on YouTube and we had a good 40, 50 people over there as well. So that's really amazing. And before I conclude, I just want to especially point out one thing. So during this pandemic and this tough time that we've been facing, along with the faculty and the staff at Chandigarh College of Architecture, it's our alumni which has really pulled together and helped us. They've stepped in whenever we needed any help or any assistance. And one of those people is Architect Anjali Sagar. So thank you so much, ma'am. You have been key and instrumental. Thank you for all your effort and your outreach. We really appreciate it. So on that note, I'm going to thank everyone once again for being part here. Ma'am, you want to say something?
Yeah, I kept bugging Sameep all the time. I wouldn't let him escape.
Yeah, no, you've been really kind of resilient to
Yeah, since February.
Since February,
this has been happening.
Yeah. Yeah. So, Anjali ma'am, your resilience has been CCS gain. So, thank you once again. Right. On that note, Sunita ma'am, with your permission, I'd like to conclude today's event and lecture.
Yes, certainly, and a big round of applause for Sameep today.
Thank you. It was lovely being here. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I hope to see you all soon. We'll have you in CCH in person.
Absolutely.
Yes. Thank you.
Absolutely love that. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Bye.